Hi, my name is Mark Ratcliff with Habitat for Humanity, and I'm here with Jordan Scroble of Grow Your Own Freedom, and we are talking raised planting beds. So we did a really neat project on site with raised planting beds and then creating a rain barrel. That you can water your garden with, and it collects all the water from your gutters and such and creates a really cool thing. Welcome, Jordan.
Yeah, thank you for
having me. How you doing?
Great.
Good.
Good to see you.
Thanks for working with us on this. It was a really fun project.
Absolutely.
We were at Jordan's house, and he has a really neat backyard that I'm excited to show you guys. So we're going to get right to the video, if that's okay,
that's
and then we'll talk about it a little bit after we're done. And we're here with UpCycle Your Habitat. And today we're on location with Jordan from Grow Your Own Freedom. And Jordan is going to show us how to take a barrel and turn it into a rain barrel, as well as repurposing that barrel to do other plantings. He'll also show you some above ground gardening and maybe a couple other treats if we're lucky. So Jordan, welcome.
Welcome. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, absolutely.
I appreciate it.
So tell me what you do here.
So what we're doing with this used 55-gallon barrel, which I actually got from my last job. It held detergent, and they were readily available. They just cut them up and throw them out as trash. I thought, you know, I can turn this into a rain barrel that I can hook up to one of my downspouts, and I can use it to water my garden.
Very cool.
Yeah.
All right, so take it from here.
Okay.
Just go to town.
Okay.
Do what you do.
Okay. So the first things that we need to think about when making a rain barrel is you have an inlet, you have something that the downspout is going to connect to fill the barrel. We have a faucet that we'll put in towards the bottom of the barrel so that you can actually, you know, tap out the water. And we'll have a filter that can screen out any sort of larger material that might end up inside the barrel. And then we also have just a little valve that will connect for an overflow once the barrel is full, so that it doesn't just keep running and overflowing. We can actually direction the water out to another place. So the first thing that I'm going to do is drill a hole for the faucet area. And I already have my measurement set up, but I'm basically going to come up. You could do it as low to the bottom of the barrel as possible, but I'm going to come up just a little bit to give myself a little bit more pressure when I'm drawing water from the barrel. So let's see. There are markings on the barrel. There's volume markings. I know that I'm going to come up just a little bit above the 10-gallon mark, but I have a measurement because I'm actually connecting this to a second barrel, and I want to make sure my faucets are about the same height. But I'm going to come up 7.5 inches from the bottom of the barrel. Which happens to put me just above the 10-gallon mark. And you can just drill an opening that's wide enough for the faucet itself, but I've found that they tend to leak over time, and that a better way is to install what's called a bulkhead fitting, which basically has two gaskets, one which would be on the inside and one which would be on the outside of the barrel. That just helps to create a little bit of a better seal, and then the faucet will thread inside this bulkhead fitting. So what I'm going to do is just drill an opening in the barrel for the bulkhead fitting. I use some fancy twine to hang the bulkhead, the one part that goes inside the barrel, down inside, since I can't reach my hand through. Okay. And then once you get it through, you just pull it tight, and I cut the twine now. Okay, so we have the bulkhead fitting has a gasket that's on the inside wall of the barrel right now, and this is the second gasket. And then this is the lock nut that secures. Gasket together. And you just tighten that down. So now that's a leak-proof seal. And then we'll take just a standard garden faucet and we'll thread that inside the bulkhead fitting. And then this allows you to turn the flow off and on, and also connect a garden hose to the faucet if you would need to. Just like that. Okay, so that's the faucet. Now we need to insert what's going to be a little storm gate that's going to go in the top of the barrel that our downspout will connect to then. And I should just mention that depending on the actual style of your downspout, you may be able to connect directly to one of these openings that are in the barrels. I don't have that ability, so what I'm going to do is drill a separate hole and then insert this, which will catch the debris. And it doesn't really matter anywhere on the top. You may just want to consider how your downspout is connecting into the barrel. So I know that mine, the downspout's kind of going to be over on this side. So I'm gonna put the hole right about here, and you just want to make sure that there is the wall of the barrel. You want to make sure you don't drill down into that. Okay, so then the little storm grate will just fit right inside there. If you would need to, you could also line this with either nylon stocking or cheesecloth if you need to filter out any finer particles, but this is good enough for if any twigs or little pine cones or something would come down through the downspout, and that way they wouldn't fill up the barrel. So we have that. And the last thing to consider then is an overflow. So once this barrel fills, you need to direction the water somewhere else. Otherwise, it'll just come out the top of the barrel and overflow by your foundation, and you do not want to do that. That's the whole purpose of the downspouts to begin with. So we're going to put an overflow valve, which can also be used to connect additional rain barrels if you should need to. And we're going to put the overflow as close to the top as possible, that way that we can maximize the amount that this barrel will hold. Because wherever you put the overflow, that's where your water will drain from as it's filling up. And so to do this, I do have it's a 3/4 inch hose adapter. So there's hose threads on there. So if you need to just connect a garden hose to it to move the water away, you can. And we're going to put this over on the right side of the barrel. Okay. And then you just thread the adapter into the plastic. If you need a little wrench, you can use that, or pliers. And you get the idea. I don't need to completely finish that. And you don't really need to worry about You could put a little bit of silicone or something on the inside of that. You don't really need to worry about it too much though. There's no pressure that you're worried about that you would have from like a typical faucet. But if you want to add a little bit of silicone, you can do that. And then once your barrel's set up, all you have to really think about doing is setting it up by your downspout. And I like to elevate the barrel a little bit, so I use a couple cinder blocks, and then you would just drill, or I'm sorry, you would just cut into your downspout to make the connection to the barrel, and that's about it.
Very cool. I like Thanks. It. Now, tell me, what is like the cost of doing this?
That's a very good question. So the one reason why I opted for a barrel that I could find for free, so that cuts down significantly on the cost. You do have the parts, so you have the little storm filter, you have the bulkhead fitting, the faucet, and the overflow. But for those parts, you're looking at $25 to $30.
Okay.
So still less than if you bought a rain barrel new, and it will pretty much last indefinitely.
So $25 to $30, does that include the barrel?
That, if you can get the barrel for free.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. What is?
But normally, I mean, maybe between $5 and $20 if you would have to buy one used.
Oh, okay.
But they're pretty easy to, I've found they're pretty easy to find.
So on the high end, you're looking at maybe $40, $20
yes.
for the barrel, another $20 for
yes.
a year.
Yes.
Yeah, very cool.
But if you were looking at buying a rain barrel, a specific rain barrel new, you'd be looking at least $100. So I think it's worthwhile if you can come across one of these. And, you know, the nice thing, okay, yeah, so it's a white barrel. It's not that attractive. It kind of works for our house, but you can also paint these any color that you'd want. You just need an appropriate primer for plastics, and then whatever sort of color that you'd like to add. And I've seen all sorts of cool designs, so it's definitely something that you can do.
Yeah.
I tend to be a little bit more on the functional side
yeah.
than the creative side, but... my wife and I are definitely considering painting these at some point to add a little bit of fun.
No, I think it looks good. It's very clean all the way around. And I think we should take a look at the other things that you've done with the rain barrels. And also, you have one of these in place. So
yeah,
I'd love to get a shot of that as well. So we can maybe you can talk us through a little bit of how you hooked it up and how you're using it.
Absolutely.
All right. So, Jordan, here we are with it completed. This is very cool how you've got it, and you've got all these black lines running everywhere. So tell me, you've certainly elevated it because it's gravity fed for the most part.
Yes.
And so tell me about it.
Yeah. So I have a platform here because, as Mark said, it is gravity fed, which means I don't have the normal faucet pressure. So if I can get it as high as I can, it just gives me a little bit more flexibility to use the water out in the garden. So I have a platform of cinder blocks, and then just a couple 2x6s to give me another inch or so. And here's my faucet. I have it connected to some leftover irrigation pipe that I had. So there's a fitting here. I'm basically going to install a second barrel right here to the left of this one. Both of those will connect to a main, I'll call it a main irrigation feeder line that then goes to our backyard, it goes into our greenhouse, and it gives me a little bit more functionality of where I can use the water. I'm gonna tap into this downspout right over here on the corner. I actually don't even have to cut into it. There's a seam about 8 feet, 9 feet up mm-hmm. that I can just disconnect, and I have a little extension here that I will connect at the top there, and then connect this into the barrel that will be right here.
Okay. And then where's the runoff?
So the runoff then is going to be on this barrel, that's this make-believe barrel that's right here. I will connect to it right here pretty much because it's going to be on the right side. And then this is the extra hose that I will just kind of run off somewhere out away from the foundation.
Okay. And this is going to be a great savings too, as far as obviously conserving water.
Yes.
But it's crazy how much water we waste and
yeah.
and just goes away. So
yes.
I think that's awesome.
Yes.
So this is one of my fascinations and something that I think is very cool. It also adds to this backyard oasis that Jordan has here. It's the bees. And we're talking about it. Jordan said it took him a while to get into it, but now that he has, just tell us a little bit about the bees and how you got going here.
So I just am fascinated with doing as many things as I can in our small backyard. And I always like the idea of having bees. Our honeybee population in the U.S. is on the decline still. And I thought, you know, whatever I can do to support that population and to continue their existence, I will do my best to do that. So there's two hives here, and they've been great, and they really have not been, they've not been a bother. I don't really have to do too much other than check on them sometimes and maybe add another box on top so that as their population is growing, they have more room for raising new bees, for storing pollen, for storing nectar, and for storing honey. And
how often would you have to harvest these a year?
So I'm hoping, last year was the first year I started, and I got a little bit of honey, which I wasn't supposed to, but I got a little bit in the fall. And now that they're going strong already, I should be able to harvest about three boxes worth per hive in around July.
Okay.
Like a little bit after 4th of July, that's typically the time period for this area, after like a good spring honey nectar flow.
And then do they produce after that?
They do.
Okay.
They do. And they'll keep recycling in these bottom three hives. Like they'll keep just replenishing their population and accessing the stored honey and raising new bees and tending to the queen.
How much honey do you think you'll be able to get out of, let's say, each one individually?
So from my calculations from last year, I harvested about the equivalent of one full box.
Okay.
I got about 20 pounds. So
wow.
I should end up with around 120 pounds of honey if both of these hives are equally strong.
Great.
Which is a lot of honey. It's about 10 gallons. It's about 5 gallons per hive of honey in July.
Yeah.
And then maybe a little bit more than in the fall.
Great. All right. And then the last thing I want to do is give you guys a little show of what Jordan has done with his above ground plantings. So we're going to go to that. So one of the other things that Jordan has on his property are these raised gardens. And I'm fascinated by them and kind of curious, why raise versus just in the ground themselves?
That's a very good question. The reason that we decided on putting in raised beds, these beds are about 6 years old at this point. And the reason we decided on that was because the soil that we had here was very, very densely compacted clay soil, so a very heavy soil, wasn't very conducive to delicate vegetable annual root growth. And we also like the idea of square foot gardening, if anybody's listening has heard of that. So we had grids set up on here initially as we were kind of learning how to garden. It made it simple for us to start, simple for us to manage.
Square foot gardening, what does that mean?
Square foot gardening basically means dividing your garden bed into 1 foot by 1 foot sections. So it gives you, especially for new gardeners, it gives you an easy way to figure out how to space things and to just kind of keep your garden bed like organized, where you can plant, you know, so many lettuces and so many radishes, beets, tomatoes, you know, in an individual grid. Yeah, I don't know, just kind of, it was a really good way for me to learn how to garden.
Okay. And the above ground gardening also allows you to control the soil that's there, maybe the amount of moisture that area will hold.
Absolutely.
And kind of delineates your space a little bit too.
Absolutely, so. Yes. It gives you, you know, a distinct garden bed with a border. You can start with really good soil from the beginning. And they actually, they do say that these beds warm up quicker in the spring, so they allow you to garden earlier. And I do actually think that is true, because I have noticed that these beds in particular up here by our patio definitely warm up faster in the springtime and allow me to put lettuces and some other greens in here very early on in the late winter or very early spring.
Cool. Jordan, great having you. Thank you so much for all the information. I love it here. I might have to buy a house across the street just so I can
figure out
what's going on.
That'd be great.
Thanks again.
Thank you.
All right. We'll be back later. So we're back. I want to thank Joe from BCTV for coming on out and filming it. He did an awesome job. And that was our first on-location shoot. So, Jordan, thanks for being there with us to be our inaugural maiden voyage for that. Anyway, so the second barrel that we did, you have hooked up now. Is that right?
Yes. Yeah, so where in the video you saw where I was showing, you know, where that imaginary barrel would be, there's two barrels set up there, and we had a really heavy rain last Friday. They both filled very quickly overnight, and I was able to utilize that water then when we were planting out some flowers over the weekend.
Great. So do you just hook a hose up to your low barrel, I'll call it, and then you tap off of that for a majority of your watering?
I do, yeah. So in the lower yard, which we didn't really see too much in the video, I have about four or five different faucet areas where I can just connect a hose to and then let it just slowly drip out over like our fruit trees and over some of the perennials that we've been planting out this year.
Just a guesstimate, and you might not know this, if we didn't have any more rain, how long would those two barrels last you for watering your backyard?
At least a couple weeks. I do apply a pretty heavy mulch layer, which really significantly helps to keep the moisture in the soil. But since we just planted a lot of stuff out, I would say probably about 2 weeks or so. As it gets warmer, that might be less. But as the roots, you know, continue to establish themselves as well, it might not be that much either. So
yeah, okay.
It's a good amount of water to have.
Very cool. That was a really neat project. So you're doing these raised gardens around the area. You told me you just did one in Moton recently.
Yep.
Tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah, so that this was for an older couple who had been gardening in the same location in a fenced-in area for the last 20 years or so. And they were just kind of getting tired of the way they were doing things. They were a little less happy with some of the results they were receiving recently. And the woman I had met at a workshop we did last year, and she had contacted me and was interested in what I would recommend doing with raised garden beds. And so last week I put in 4 raised beds for her, filled them with really good soil, mulched the area, so it's a nice finished garden area that looked, in their words, very professional.
Cool. And so you do a number of raised garden beds, but do you do anything else for people at their house?
Right now, my wife and I, who's my partner in the business, we've also planted out some perennial flowers from time to time, and also some fruit trees and fruit bushes and some like strawberries. Those are relatively easy things to start growing, and is a nice perennial addition to your garden.
Yeah. So if you're growing lettuce, which seems like one of the simpler things to grow, how much lettuce will that garden yield? I'll say. I don't know if that's too technical, but how much lettuce can you get out of that?
The one garden in the video that we were kind of kneeling down by and we were talking over, right now that garden is almost fully planted with lettuce, mm-hmm. and I expect to be able to, you know, harvest greens from that probably at least through July. And then in the middle of the summer, when it's super hot here, lettuce doesn't always do that well. It starts to become a little bitter, mm-hmm. but at least for the next 2 months, I should be covered for a large salad every day.
That's awesome. Are there hardier leafy greens that you can plant, such as kale and those kind of things?
Kale definitely can last all summer. Swiss chard does very well. And a type of spinach called New Zealand spinach is also very prolific in the heat of the summer around
here. That's good to know.
I'm a
big spinach eater.
Yeah.
So
it's a little different than the typical spinach, but the leaves are a little bit more succulent. I think they're a little more buttery, so they're a little better cooked rather than raw in a salad. But they're a good green to have over the summer with very little pest problems.
That's cool. So tell me about the other things that you have growing in your lower garden.
So as of last year, we have several varieties of fruit trees, fruit bushes. We have European pears, Asian pears, pawpaws, persimmons, both American and Asian, jujubes, blueberries, strawberries, raspberries, like...
You name it.
Yeah. I try to get as much variety as possible and also set up the garden in a way that we can harvest fruit for as many months over the growing season as possible.
Yeah. And did you do a, did you do lemon?
Did you do a... I do have, yes, you remember.
Yeah,
I did decide to get a small dwarf, it's called a Meyer lemon. It's a little different than the lemon that we'd get at the store. It's a little more sweet, a little more fruity. But I can't plant that in the ground around here, but I can put it in a pot and then bring it indoors over the wintertime. And the flowers are out of this world, very fragrant, unlike anything I've ever been exposed to. And that was kind of my splurge for this season.
That's neat. When you bring it indoors, do you treat it differently indoors?
I need to give it as much sunlight as possible. So like the sunniest room in the house, it really needs to be in there by the window. And you know, just need to kind of monitor the water usage, because over the winter time it's a little drier inside. So I need to just make sure that the soil stays adequately moist but not wet. And that's about it.
Great. Yeah,
sunlight's the main thing.
That was honestly very cool. I love being in your backyard, especially the bees. But so next month we're going to come back to you. It's Mother's Day this month, so don't forget your mom. Get outside, get her a great plant. Next month we're going to focus on Father's Day, and hopefully Heather will be back with us next month, and we'll do some fun Father's Day gifts, because he's awesome, at least he, right? Wouldn't you agree?
Yes.
Dads are awesome. So anyway, we want to thank you for joining us at Upcycle Your Habitat, and we look forward to seeing you again soon.